We are going to have a first talk on our symposium by Bracha Ettinger. She is an Israel-born psychoanalyst and artist. In the late 1970s, she moved to London, working, and where she was working, in the context of the British School of Psychoanalysis, for instance, with Ronald Lang. In 1981, she decided to become a professional artist and moved to Paris. She works mainly in oil painting, but some of you may also know her photographs, especially the photographs she did or took of Emmanuel Levinas. Her main contribution to psychoanalytical theory is her shaping of a matrixial sphere that she relates to early experiences in early infancy and even prenatal experiences of maternity as a source for sexual difference for both daughters and sons. She analyzes experiences stemming from early infancy, such as primordial fantasies and even prenatal sensual affective sensations. She calls them a transjective connectedness that is neither objective nor subjective, but that become elements of the later I. Her work relates to our symposium on the horizons of horror, insofar as her work both in psychoanalytic theory and in aesthetics addresses experiences of horror and anxiety, researches their place in the subject's formation in infancy and throughout his whole biography. She has contributed to aesthetics, shedding light on the aesthetic experiences of beauty and the experience of the sublime, especially the latter, so the experience of the sublime. She suggests to think beyond the uncanny and anxiety which they are usually characterized by. Today she will present a paper on what she calls the Laios complex. Laios is that character in the Greek cosmos of myth who intended to kill his son Oedipus. For her, the Laios complex is a delirium. One also could call it a horror film, a nightmare version of a father. Maybe you're familiar with the Freudian Oedipus complex that describes the ways a subject overcomes his desire to kill the father in rivalry for the mother's love, and in the end, if all goes well, forms a loving relationship to that father. Bracha Ettinger opposes the matrixial as a mother-child relationship, as a dyadic relationship of female parenthood, to the Laios delirium, as a dyadic relationship of male parenthood. What came to my mind are the figures and fantasies of what Bracha Ettinger, in another article of hers, called the ready-made mother monsters of psychoanalytical theory. The most famous of these ready-made mother monsters is Winnicott's concept of the not good enough mother. That confined psychotherapy to make up for the neglect during childhood and assign to the psychoanalyst the role of a good enough mother. Bracha Ettinger named two other primordial fantasies of monstrous mothers, the abandoning mother, that is the one that would leave you tonight in the devil's moor and causes anxiety. And the second mother monster fantasy is the devouring mother, a mother that overdetermines you and over dominates you. Maybe I can body her in the during that symposium. Mother monsters, or readymades are, as she tells them, human early tools for organizing the not sufficient reality of living in the world and encountering other human beings and giving early explanations for existential anxieties. I'm very much looking forward to her talk on the Lajos complex that seems to be a ready-made father monster.
Thank you very much for inviting me, and I'm really glad to see all of you who came from different places. And I hope to enjoy this weekend together and learn a lot. Indeed, I will present this delirium of Lajos, the Lajos delirium, the Lajos complex, but hopefully also will give some clues to how we move from that anxiety, the uncanny anxiety in the meeting of with that which suddenly comes to life and horrifies us, etc. We could differentiate in this anxiety some other affective modus that are a bit neglected, perhaps, that we easily translate into a horror, and which are compassion and awe in their primary modes. But let's start with the monsters. First chapter is called The Death Gift, From Abraham to Kafka, Father Figure, The Delirium of Lajos. And I start with a quote from Derrida. God is the name of the possibility I have of keeping a secret that is visible from the interior, but not from the exterior. Once such a structure of conscious exists, of being with oneself, of speaking, that is, of producing invisible sense, once I have within me, thanks to the invisible world as such, a witness that others cannot see, and who is therefore at the same time other than me and more intimate with me than myself, once I have a secret relationship with myself and not tell everything, once there is a secrecy and secret witness within me, then what I call God exists. I call myself God. God calls me. If it is on that condition that I can call myself, or that I am called in secret, God is in me. He is the absolute me or self. He is that structure of absolute anteriority that is called, in Kierkegaard's sense, subjectivity. And he is made manifest. He manifests his non-manifestation when in the structures of the living or the entity, there appears in the course of philo and ontogenetic history the possibility of secrecy, however differentiated, complex, plural, and overdetermined it be. That is, when there appears the desire and power to render absolutely invisible and to constitute within oneself a witness of that invisibility. That is the history of God, and the name of God is the history of secrecy, a history that is at the same time secret and without any secrets. Such history is also an economy, and if it's an economy, it's also a politics. And let's think about Abraham, the biblical Abraham first. Sacrifice without sacrifice, according to Derrida, in that same paper, is the history of men only. Male fathers, male sons. Each time a son is lost, then saved by the father, intended for sacrifice, then saved by the father, pushed to fall but then caught up by the father alone, is it not an Abrahamic root? Man's endless debt towards sacrifice without sacrifice of the finally saved son. Here we are. Derrida emphasizes that death giving to the son is a man's only affair. But is it not a perverse man-only affair when pushed to an edge where the son is not at all saved? A kind of perversion, father version, to use the favorite expression of Lacan. In perversion, the objectivity of the other is affirmed and its vulnerability is denied. The Kafkaesque son is oppressed. The type of son Kafka puts himself in and brings about is expressed by the pretense of innocence of the destructive father. So we have here an addition, that father that caused you to fall also pretends to innocence. Franz Kafka's father saw in his infant a true monster, and thus he became his tyrant. Kafka writes to the father, whose game he will always lose. From your armchair, you ruled the world. Your opinion was correct. Every other was mad, wild, meshuge, not normal. According to Walter Benjamin, fathers in Kafka's strange family batten on their sons, lying on top of them, giant like giant parasites. They not only prey upon their strengths, but gnaw away at the son's right to exist. The father's punished, but they are at the same time the accusers. The sin of which they excuse the son seems to be a kind of original sin. I quote, "One is sentenced not only in innocence, but also in ignorance." In Kafka's writing, law is contained in books, but these are secret. By basing itself on them, the prehistoric world exerts its rule all the more ruthlessly. The Kafkaesque perfect crime, according to Jean-François Lyotard, does not consist in killing the victim or the witnesses, but rather in obtaining the silence of the witnesses, the deafness of the judges, and the craziness, insanity, of the testimony. So it's not enough, the idea that we are horrified and shocked. There is a supplementary condition that when you report on that, you are not believed. Jean-François Lyotard speaks of the wrong as the damage that goes together with the loss of means to prove the part of the other in one's damaging oppressing. One loses these means, for example, if the author of the damages turns out directly or indirectly to be one's judge. Ordinary communication is not enough for such a situation. A différend. This is what he announced. One need to invent idioms in order to be able to describe this différend. How can a subject resist injustice when the father not only rules the system of justice, but also appropriates the right to disobey it, occupying both positions, that of a narcissistic child and that of a father? The machine is bigger than what Oedipus can contain. Deleuze and Guattari identify in their book Kafka toward the minor literature an exaggerated Oedipus in action when the Oedipal machine gets mad. But in my view, it is not even an exaggerated Oedipus. Rather, it is Elias. Unconscious or simply hidden, the son can discover the secret of Oedipus. After all, it is the subject as son who invented the Oedipus complex. What the son cannot discover is the secret of Abraham, and perhaps up to a point only. What the sun can never discover is the secret of liars. Such is precisely the material kept out of the sun's reach. Isaac doesn't guess the intentions of Abraham, and if he does, he assumes for him the innocence he claims. But the son of liars is not meant to survive. If he survives, his witnessing will enter the idiom of differend. It will not be heard. The witness will be silenced, his testimony considered insane. And I want to put one remark more directly connected to some kind of horror films. Why these horror films and horror in certain kind of art? The horror in art, that which is invented, not that which touches a real violence, becomes the problem of the viewer in the sense that I described. What we see has been composed in the artist's mind, but the viewer is the vessel of the artist's object of paranoia. It is the reader who will continue to fear that someone will pluck out his eyes, like in Hoffman's story. The writer sets some seducing fruit for the eyes of the reader. The filmmaker, some fruits for the eyes of the viewer. But is the reader or the viewer who enters or continues the process of losing trust, losing some more of his trusting capacity, losing compassion ability, losing on the innocence of wandering, while enjoying the thrill of fear, yet to be forever slightly more worried, more afraid of what the other and the world has to offer. The difference between the invented object of horror and the violence of the world brought to remembrance by the artist is then difference in the potentiality for compassion and wonder as related to beauty and to the humane, and for the sublime as related to reverence of nature and awe for its wonder, and which are long-lasting, even if moderate transformational agency that allow the viewer and the reader pause for reflection. A pause for reflection in wondering versus instant jouissance of fear, a thrill, the thrilling which gives instant pleasure and results in more paranoia, increasing the velocity of such jouissance and calling for addiction, which is simultaneously the freezing fascinum affect that arrests life and prepares for long-lasting creeping fears based on shocks, untransformed shock. So why certain kind of horror films? Precisely for this purpose, to use the hunger or addiction for immediate jouissance to turn society more paranoiac, fearful, and therefore obedient. So much so that paranoia has become transparent, and our paranoiac society is reflected to us from the media as neutral, while the media is loosening our capacity for resistance. And I think that there the role of the artist and the concepts that can allow us to think what we are doing in works of art, even horror works of art, versus something else, which for me is a horror propaganda or horror pornography, and all these little nuances that we can work out. Well, it is there that we can work the question of what could be transformational and what could not be transformational when we as viewer are put in the state of shock of this Kafka sun. And I continue with Kafka and with Oedipus. Behind the Kafkaesque power mechanism of the law, understood by Deleuze and Guattari as magnification and exaggeration of Oedipus complex, A more powerful secret mechanism function in the psychic and social field, originating in my view from the position of paternality in Elias complex. By paternality, of course, I don't mean that this is genderly determined and it must be a man figure. You know, paternality is a function. Secret father-son links are established under this perversion. When the paternal perfect crime, when to the paternal perfect crime, the son Kafka replied with a seemingly Oedipal masquerade, it is perhaps because a son, caught in the Laius delirium of a father, cannot discover his secret and truly live. So let's talk about Laius. What are the elements, the ingredients of this position? Laius abducted and raped Chrysippus, the son of a king who was his host. In trying to escape Laius, Chrysippus fell or jumped from the top of a hill and was killed. When Laius' own son Oedipus was born, Laius ordered him killed on Mount Citerion. The impulse of Laius is double. The first is envious, erotic, aggressive, to seduce his friend's son and then rape him, to own his youth treasures, his beauty, perhaps his creativity. This he cannot help. If another father's son jumps to his death, the real father's pain, Laius doesn't share. It's another father who will suffer. Then follows a second impulse to kill his own son. Now, this is one of the horrors we hardly dare to think, either as the children or as the parent. What is this denied instinct? And how can it be denied in view of all the horrors we see, the wars, and the sending of children to fight? The abducted host's son was killed. The natural son was saved by a shepherd. The shepherd is the one who, like the mother preceding our birth, carries. The carrier Phil knows in the real some secret that mothers, birthing or not birthing, already know. A value the dial stands for its destruction. Elias' delirium might fatally hit a father-son relation. If Abraham's secret is a secret sacrifice without sacrifice, Abraham seduced his son to death, then saved him before he fell. Laius is a secret sacrifice per se, the perfect crime. When to Derrida's Abrahamic death gift and to Kierkegaard's sacrifice, I add the Laius secret delirium. The difference nuance concerns the perfect crime of betrayal combined with the paternal pretense of innocence. So we have the notion of pretense of innocence, we have the notion of betrayal. What is destroyed is not only the particular trust in the particular father figure. What is destroyed little by little is our capacity to trust, our capacity to open into the world in wandering, to open into the world with all kinds of love, rather than with a certain pre-built panic and the rejection. Laius' act doesn't enter the economy of sacrifice without sacrifice, but a projective, paranoid, narcissistic commerce of the enactment of symbolic death-giving to a son object by way of a seduction into death. To to avoid being succeeded by a creative son, and to live the fantasy of surviving the son, the father seduces him to self-destruction. The symbolization of Elias' projective paranoid sin is disguised by one prevailing law or by another, by some kind of social framing. Betrayal not only in the name of rule fixed by the paternal figure, but moreover, betrayal under the wings of the relationship confidentiality, a secret betrayal. Such a parental desire for death gift, kept secret by the rules of the father alone, a desire which originates in the becoming father subjectivity of the father figure, or the father analyst, or the father filmmaker, and not from the infantile father symbol and father image that the son analysand holds, is structured into a Elias complex hidden behind the Oedipus complex, masked by it, but entirely different from it. The difference lies in the idea of the dyad. You know that we usually think about the law or about the symbolic function or the symbolic name of the father as a function of the third, the law that separates a dyadic relationship. And the dyadic relationship usually considered maternal and symbiotic. We are entering a dyad with the mother, and the father function is to separate this dyad in view of continuity of life. So the idea that the father-son relation can also be dyadic and in some senses might need another kind of separation of a feminine or maternal kind is something that I hope to convince psychoanalysis that we need to think about in terms of the matrixial and in terms of other concepts. So it is dyadic, something we find hardly to we can imagine. It does not enter triangulation. It is dyadic, it catches you up in the throat in an immediate way. This unique son is dangerous to me, this unique father. He must be sacrificed to calm down some not yet, yet as if symbolic paternality in a dyad that no mother, m/other can enter and can guess. The betrayal strike is enacted under some low fulfilling mask. Laios hides himself behind some symbolically sustained paternal masquerade offered to the community. Derrida marks the difference between unknown as mystery, a forever secret, and unknown as simply hidden. The Laios death gift is, in my view, a well-hidden, well-kept, and unacknowledged secret. The son, patient, analysant, me as a viewer, enters the realm of the sacrificed through the symbolic father, analyst's promise to offer the son some future love. That is, through the analyst's assumed occupation of the locus of a maternal seduction into life. First weaving himself in this originary matrixial web, then tearing it apart. The betrayal of the trust that emerged in this stratum is a catastrophe to the psyche. Can the awareness to the matrixial sphere moderate Elias' delirium? In my view, yes. In a subject space of ethical carrions is a concept that I was working on in the last few years, and we will talk about it soon. In a subject space of ethical carrions, The economy of it's either you or me will fail. This calls for the introduction of ethics at the heart of the transferential field. The matrixial symbolic calls upon the father-son dyad to mark a space that will fail its economy of it's either me, your father, or you, my son. Not only the liars non-maternal, yet dyadic economy must be revealed. We can also offer to try to transform it. Its alternative, yet twin triadic pact, edifice and economy, that of the secret paternal sacrifice without sacrifice, the Abrahamic secret, can be opened to more daylight as well. This pact says it's either my God, that is whatever I believe in, or you, my son. This is also called to be transformed. It is called to be transformed when we think about the subject, each subject, as always in transconnectedness to the other, which is its object, but also its transject and transsubject. The symbolic of and symbolization and sublimation from corporeal carrions from care and carry, can moderate the sacrificial delirious dyad and the imaginary triad, there where no woman mother is represented either. If the foreclosed archaic maternality enters the structure of the subject itself. In order not to remain so heavily pessimistic, I will move now to some ideas about the transformation of these basic anxieties. And I would like to ask you, I know that some of the notions and the concepts are not familiar or familiar to some of you and not familiar to others. So I'm going to ask you to just take it floatingly and easily and try to jump over concepts that you don't know in the hope that we will work it out in the days we have here together. But in the meanwhile, just to say them the way you wish, we will consolidate it a bit more in tomorrow, perhaps, or after tomorrow. I'd like to talk about, you know, that when I refer to the affective and when I refer to partial subjects and partial objects, I refer to a zone which always involves also the human. It might be subject-object, it might be subject-subject, it might be me and the cosmos or a natural event, but always a human subject in this, and in that sense it is invested with feelings too. And for me also art, at one pole of it is for the human, no matter how it is made, but art is for the human and even for the humane, even if this human is partly non-human anymore or post-human. So what about that human? We have a stratum, a matrixial stratum, where we are connected. We have material or non-material strings that connect us, and there is a kind of a vocabulary to explain how this is possible with and in the human. And recent years, I call it also the domain of the subreal, so that whenever in psychoanalysis and in Lacanian psychoanalysis, we talk about You can move them. We can. What we see here are details from only one painting of mine, one oil painting that I was doing for about 4 or 5 years, and I did not absolutely yet decide what will be its name, what will be its title. It runs between Eurydice, Medusa, and Pietà, and it refers to Caravaggio, Medusa, and to this Kronos who eats his children of Goya. So I'm referring to a strat that I call subreal in order to address the psyche, the psycho drama of this transconnectedness, which is not visible, which is not articulated well enough, which is on the edges of perceptibility, on the edges of what we can put our hands on. Therefore, we cannot control it, but we are working for transformation in that field. Abstract subreal threading resonates with human and with the cosmic. The invisible cords, co-weaved, find venues in and to the visible plan. When carrions, this capacity to carry or to be carried, is sensed and thus transcends, when it reaches a full-blown desire, the symbolic opens to the subreal. So this is one of the ways how we can enter our consciousness or awareness of these nets that connect us through a certain, with the idea of carrions enters already the responsibility and responsibility measure. This is on the pole of the ethics of the artwork and of the artist. So we can see that here that a certain desire for trust, not for being shocked, can be harmonized with a revision of the notion of resistance. That it can be a tool of resistance for this paranoid proposition that the world keeps offering us and we are feeding and fed by. Another of my concept is witnessing. Witnessing a twin term, but in difference from witnessing, where the one which witnesses and even offers a critique is also implicated. Witnessing. Witnessing and vision, invisible, color light and affect forms are subreal. So the emergence of a space in terms of the space of the film, the space of the painting, the space of the encounter, or the installation, emergence of space and critique join in the passage, a passage from witnessing to witnessing, a passage from being passively affected and affecting in respect of the subreal. Imagine a subject as a carrion's space. Imagine the space subject that carries the carrier. We have here both the idea that we might be responsive and we might resist imaginary identity. And I think that the resistance of imaginary identity has to do also with what I heard this morning about the xenofeminism and the resistance to the identification as gender, and also to Anselm's idea of the relations of subject and object. More directly, what could be offered when we are affected by the uncanny anxiety? And uncanny anxiety, of course, this is Freud, in the basis of his description of the feeling of the uncanny, is the passage from the non-animated to the animated. This is one of the sources that he points out for horror, when what we expect not to move suddenly start to move, when we expect something to be non-human, it is suddenly human. And I think that Freud would enjoy a lot the popularity of his idea of the uncanny, which is the major contribution to aesthetic theory and to art. Not the only one, but a major one. And what I add is that on that very, very primary level, where uncanny anxiety is evoked, and where we feel that we are on the borderline of the invisible, on the borderline of the believable, we don't know if to jump back or stay in, on that precise level of primary affectivity, we also have two kinds of primary affects that are easily swollen by it. The primary affect of compassion, which makes us desiring to approach, and the primary affect of awe, which keep us in relation to whatever it is that frighten us. But it does not frighten us in a way that is going to destroy us. It frightens us because we realize that it is bigger than us. It is bigger than us, but we remain in awe, not in fear. And I think that this is very actual to rethink in terms of awe and in terms of compassion. Also Kant was thinking in this term, but for now it would be in terms of primary affects in relation to the world and to the maternal and to objects. And if we stay long enough and we are not running away with fear, we might start to give rise to these kind of feelings. And so the question is how to work as artists and transform objects and situation in such a way that will not increase fear in us, but will also provoke the possibility to stay there and not being controlled by the whatever is offered to us. And it is particularly important because we have also renounced too much on the idea that we might remain in awe in front of natural phenomena and allow nature, you know, to say it words in that way, and not think that we are always better, stronger, or have to run away. And the last part of my intervention, we will go, as you said, beyond the Freudian uncanny anxiety, the unheimlich. And by this I mean beyond that fatal association between haunting and daunting aesthetic phenomena and the affect of anxiety. Experiencing beauty, experiencing the sublime, imply, I'm convinced, that primary affects other than anxiety are encountered too. Affects that are connected, like anxiety is, to the early human states of helplessness, they hint at a state that even more archaic helplessness, if such expression should apply here at all, had evoked. Once upon a time, before it had evoked anxiety, a silent overwhelmedness of the pre-I, the oceanic feeling of within the unity of self and other, self and the cosmos, self and the primary sense of being alive, which not only was not connected to anxiety, and not only was sometimes connected to undifferentiated bliss, but which also had involved other primary affects, affects that bring about the experience and emotion of wondering, admiring, and amazement, and accompany them as originary emotions, experiences, during the process where you are staying there with, process of differentiating in jointness within units, transsubjective and transjective units. This silent overwhelmedness allows for some apprehension of the shared space and continuity, not the cut, between I, self, and non-I. When the I is in differentiation from and in co-birthing with the non-I. Now, I talk a lot about, of course, infant and the pre-maternality and jointness in pregnancy, but that's not the point. The point is not going to the past. The point is that in the presence, at every living moment, we are also transconnected in these archaic ways. It is not that once upon a time we have been connected in that way and then we developed, but it is the fact that as the human being is born, when we are born, since we have been born through pregnancy, already minds and spirits and psyche and body had found a way to coexist and co-emerge, and this kind of sensitivity and sensibility we have all throughout our lives. So we are not talking about being a daughter or mother or feminine in that sense. We are talking about whatever it is that must enter our understanding of subjectivity and of the object-subject ways of relating on this quivering, resonant level. This silent overwhelmedness allows for some apprehension of the shared space and continuity, not the cut between I and non-I. Once a continual contact had taken place, time duration, psychic sharing and continuity continues to occur in some aspect at a certain level. Continuity and a vibration of shared psychic strings. The partial I, the partial subject, and then the subject itself that evolves from it, works through traces of this vibration, looks for the resonance of its frequency, where the wandering relates to passivity and admiring to activity, along and around the same affective arousal, which is not only that of anxiety, but also that of amazement. Thus, the other, for the I, subject or object or partial object, is an entity that begins not in objecting, rejecting, and splitting. The other, to begin with, is not the site of rejected psychic material, but of continuity and a shared affective trembling. Beauty, this last barrier before the emergence of the death drive in life,
or the revelation and admittance of the occurrence of death, the last barrier before the horror is also the last barrier from the knowledge of known life as pre-birth, as that which emerges. This beauty overwhelms and amazes, and precisely by this affective touch, it gives me a passage to another world while offering me access to my own future, subjective, non-subjective, and even to my non-subjectivized past, to that which we left on the road, to the traces that we could not relate to. The true work of art, in my view, echoes this beauty of the pre and the post subject and the transject at the present, in the moment, and in the object itself. I ask myself the question, is it indeed angst, or is it just or mainly angst with which I, as an artist, open myself to the other and the cosmos, risking, like Eurydice, my own fading and disappearance again and again? What is the thing, or what are the things that overwhelm me so? And how is this amazement connected to art? And what is art anyway? This is a constant question. Every day I ask myself, what is art? And how do I know something by artworking, through the doing of the practicing the artworking? There is this human condition described in Hebrew by the word de'aga, with its verb lidog and its root dag, that means to worry and to have concern for, to take care for and about. I am concerned and involved as I take care and then as I carry. I don't only collect, contain, and archive. I care for your needs while I worry about you. But do I necessarily take care of whoever and whatever worries me? When do worry and care meet? What is this worry-caring to which I give a time of my soul, which moved me to artworking and give my life a sense, of a sense in and by the work? And what kind of care, worry, caring, carry-ons move the viewer to participate in the affective sphere that the work creates? So the affective sphere could be a sphere that causes me shock, and when it causes me shock, it blocks me, and when it blocks me, it does not transform me. It needs something more. Consider and say is the passive force of a mixture of affective strings of compassion and awe, even without their connectivity to any object, to any supposed cause of their arousal. I think of this mixture as a psychic concerned arousal, an arousal in concerning, arousal and not anxiety. So we can talk about uncanny arousals, not only uncanny anxieties. In arousal would not be reactive. Anxiety would be reactive. And the question whether I am responding to the world or simply being reactive is also one of the questions we can put to ourselves. In this paper where I did not read more, but I started to read, I also talk on the root in Hebrew, on the root in Hebrew of the verb to carry and the verb subject. In English and in other languages, we have the subjugation, right? in the subject, there is a certain passivity in the root of the word already in the subject. In Hebrew, though it is not visible at first sight, though it is really on the surface, the word subject and the word to carry are the same word. And so from that, I could say, in terms of the artist and the question of what is the subject of in the art making, I carry, therefore I am. A definition that is self-propelling itself in the word subject itself. Now, is it comfortable when I talk in this distance? It's okay for you? Together with uncanny compassion and uncanny awe, and even as a reaction to those affects, uncanny anxiety is often experienced. And indeed, not only it is difficult to distinguish between those affects when they are mixed in different dose, but it is also difficult to extract them in their special uniqueness once they are followed by anxiety. And yet it is important to extract them from the reservoir of anxiety into which such different affects are gathered, to distinguish between them and to allow their effect to direct us both at an emotional level and in comprehending thinking aesthetics, and finally also ethics. They are gathered together because with compassion, the shadows of compassion also arise, shadows that turn between disgust and pity, contempt and sadistic or masochistic traits that form the possibility to humiliate. And so the cord that links compassion to its shadow is coiled. Compassion and awe are being gathered together because with awe, the shadows of the awe arise too, shadows that turn between fear, shame, and envy, affront and sadistic or masochistic traits. And so the cord that links awe and its shadows is coiled too. The cords are coiled around inside the subject. They oppress the subject, first of all on their own account, but also because of the guilt connecting these shadows. Thus, beyond anxiety, uncanny effects are channeled towards anxiety. These shadows fall or are projected onto the present, disappearing and the a priori lacking object, which realizes whatever the psyche is missing in the other to which it is referring. I will explain this in a moment. Anxiety follows when self-relinquishment turns into surrendering. Suddenly, self-relinquishment can turn into a flight or fight. When one is swimming inside such a reservoir, it is difficult to distinguish between vulnerability and fragility, fragilization and self-fragilization. It is difficult to distinguish between the free self-relinquishment and surrendering out of frailty. When the shadows of the affects are projected onto the other of the eye, the vulnerability of the other becomes transparent. The subject does not apprehend it anymore. The subject moves in the world as if it were on its own. In a similar way, we are unaware of the frequencies and vibration of the cosmos out of a similar kind of blindness, but on a non-personal level, a blindness that is translated into fear from our own death and negation on of our own death, which are at the same time fear and negation of all futures. If one is not flooded by the contact with these shadows and does not look for causes to be blamed for their appearances, either in the inside or in the outside, the connecting of encompassing with fascinance becomes creative and reveals beauty. And the connecting of being filled with awe with fascinance reveals the sublime. The capacity for encompassing and being awful beyond anxiety allows us to dignify the other and the cosmos, both at the level of the subject, inside, interiorized others, and in the world per se. A return of the capacity to respect goes together with the placement of respect at the site of the other and in the space of the cosmos. So perhaps what I'm also saying that is that we can distinguish when we look at works of art that are treating and relating to horror between those that leaves us only with those shadows that fall into anxiety and more helpless and more paranoiac, and those who are doing this work of art, this artworking of making in us and in them a kind of a space in which we can survive the shock and start to have moments of meditations and reflection and the before and the after and the critique and arising our possibility of criticizing. And the last thing I would like to say in relation to that is that when we think about objects and subject and or partial subject and part object with which we are connecting, not necessarily relating, but connecting, we can bring into account on the subreal level the level of their or the frequency and the resonance of each thing in us or in emotional moments in us and in the object and in the colors and the lines and the light and the colors that we are creating and the continuities we're creating, the musicality of the things. And imagine that there is, let's call it the kernel of the object or the subject and my own kernels, and imagine them instantly in some kind of resonance so that kernel is connected to another kernel, not through a more collected, identified modus of subjectivity. And I hope that our attention can be brought to that so we can realize more deeply how it is not possible to destroy something in the other or in the world without destroying something in our own matrixial webs. That is, to destroy is to self-destroy. We can stop here, no?